Thank you to Shari Zion for opening the doors for this evening's lecture. And a special thank you to Sam Finkelstein for all that he's done for the lecture. Rishus, Rabbi Hafer is a beacon of light to our entire community and to our Mishpacha B'Kratz. And with special recognition to all the sponsors and to all those who made this evening possible. Inshallah Hashem, Yibuchem Atoy, may you continue to have the Siyat Nishmaya to be your Rabbi Yisrael. I was sitting in the dentist's office a week ago, and a fellow sitting next to me says, so I see you're speaking, huh? I said, yes, I am. What are you talking about? He said, I'll be speaking about Shuma. Are you going to be saying anything new? So I said, you know, with over 3,000 years of tshuva drushes having been given, it would be hard for me to predict or to think or to boast that I'm saying something new. But I came across an incredible story. A story that happened with Rav Mordechai of Vilkash. Yes, it's a real city. And Rav Mordechai of Vilkash was the abbezdin in the city, and he had a shul. And what happened was, there was a gzeira, a decree that came out, and the bishop of the church decreed that there should be no houses of prayer open other than his house of prayer. Well, it was a terrible tragedy. Shuls were closed, they were boarded up, but as Hashgacha would have it, one shul's Ezra's Nashim remained open. And so the people of Ramatul Shul would go and they would gather quietly in the back of Ezra's Nashim, and they would sneak into the shul, and this Zeder happened Erev Shavuos, and for the next few months they would daven in the Ezra's Nashim of the shul, until one day it was Erev Rishchodesh Elul. And Ramatul Vilkash started to shake. And he thought to himself, not only is the shul closed, but our tefillahs have been closed up. We haven't been able to pour out our hearts and our nefashis and our souls. And therefore, he gathered them together and he says, Rabbi said, we must be able to bribe the bishop to somehow break free of this terrible zayah. And that's what they did. They broke free by making a collection. And they collected money from all the men, and the women collected from the women, and they were able to bribe the bishop to open up the shul. Erev Rosh Hashanah, the shul opened. A year passed, and no one really remembered much of the incident. All went smoothly until the night of Beis El. Rav Mordechai of Vilkash had a dream. And in the dream, an old man comes to him and he says, Rav Mordechai, what happened? What happened? He says, what do you mean what happened? He says, no drushes here? No Divrei Sefer? Not making up the Olam? It's a Shchodesh Elul. And it passed. He said, but the shul's open. He says, Adrabah. There's a Medrash that tells us that there was a king that made a decree, and he said that everybody in the city, everybody in the village has to pay taxes. Well, the elders and the king of the city went out to greet the king, and they said to the royal highness, please, we beg you. He said, okay, I'll pardon a third of the taxes. And then the regular people in the city, they stood by the gates as the king approached, and they said, please, we have no money. And he said, I'll pardon another third. And finally, he came to the town square, to the town center. And the pshut dayan, the simpletons of the city are standing there, and they said, Your Royal Majesty, we have nothing. And he said, okay, fine. And the old man said to Ramatul in the dream, he said, the king is waiting to pardon your taxes. You're going to wait to the last minute, only a third will get pardoned. Beg now. And Ramatul got the message. And from then on, every Rosh Chodesh Elul, he would give a fiery shmooze. Am I saying anything new tonight? I don't know. But one thing is for sure. It has to be said. Because the king is coming to collect his taxes. The decrees are being made, and we have to beg. the earlier the better, to ask the king to pardon us. And tshuva, you should know, tshuva, the word itself, connotes nothing new. We're simply returning